Hi, everyone. Thanks for showing up. And hopefully, between all of us and getting the word out, we can stop the sale of the Elliott State Forest. I don't know if you guys know much about the Elliott or have hiked there, but it's the largest contiguous coastal forest in Oregon. And half of it has never been cut. There was a wildfire in the 1850s, but half of it is old growth and important habitat for a lot of endangered species. So we have a lot of reasons to keep it in public hands. And tonight, Max Beacon has come from Coos Bay. Max is an ecologist who lives on Oregon's south coast. He graduated from the University of Oregon Institute of Marine Biology in Charleston, Oregon. He worked as a fisheries biologist in Alaska, and then he moved back to the coast and helped start the Coast Range Forest Watch, which he has been co-director of since the group formed 5 years ago. Coast Range Forest Watch has coordinated a team of volunteer biologists every summer to survey for the endangered marbled murrelet in Oregon's Coast Range, with most of their surveys being done in the Elliott State Forest. The group has also been a leader in the Save the Elliott Coalition of the South Coast residents fighting to keep the Elliott State Forest in public ownership. So I'd like for you all to welcome Max and enjoy the presentation, and like John said, there'll be plenty of time to talk for questions and answers afterwards, and ways you guys can plug in. Spread the word, get active, and help save our forests. Okay, Max.
Hey there, everybody. So I want to tell you a little bit about who we are, who I am, and who I work with in Coos Bay. Our group, the group that I started with some other people, is called Coast Range Forest Watch, and we do surveys, volunteer surveys for the marbled murrelet. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of a marbled murrelet. Okay, most people have. Marbled murrelet, for those who haven't, is a small seabird. It's about the size of a robin, also the size of a potato, a large potato. Its nickname is the flying potato because it's a very dense little bird. When it's flying, it never stops flapping its wings because its wings are made for swimming underneath the ocean to catch prey. However, like a lot of alcids, which the murrelet is in the family of alcids, they like to nest on high up, out of reach places. So unlike other alcids, the marbled murrelet nests in old growth forests. So what we do is we go out and watch the sky starting at sunrise. It turns out marbled murrelets are very early risers, actually starting 45 minutes before sunrise. So sometimes that means starting your hike to your survey station at like 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. It's a pretty early day, but we go out there and stand there and look for signs of the murrelet nesting in old growth forests. And if they show up and we can document it, that means that that area is protected under the Endangered Species Act. So usually we go to places where there are planned timber harvests in old growth habitat. And if we find murrelets, that usually stops things, at least slows them down. So that's who we are and what we do as Coast Range Forest Watch. A few years ago, I guess it was almost 3 years ago now, when the plan to sell the Elliott State Forest came out, we found ourselves in the unique position of being the only active local environmental organization in Coos Bay. And we also happened to do a lot of work in the Elliott State Forest with our surveys, and decided that it seemed like we were the people that should be kind of like getting the word out to the locals about the Elliott State Forest. When we started talking to people about the Elliott being sold at the very early stages, we were surprised at how many people had no idea that the state was thinking about selling the forest, even after the news. And you know, things take a while to trickle down sometimes, I guess, but people we talked to at the farmers market and everything were really upset because a lot of people there use the forest and have used it for generations and hunt there and fish there and hike there. And you know, so it's a pretty important issue locally. But a lot of those people who cared a lot about the Elliott State Forest, and still do, of course, don't really care about marbled merlets. There's Coos Bay is a historically a logging town, and a lot of people there really believe in ecological integrity and protecting endangered species. But a lot of people there also worked in mills or timber fallers or in timber families. And when the spotted owl timber wars 1990s thing happened, it was a pretty sharp divide that happened in the community. So we kind of decided to start this coalition, the Save the Elliott State Forest Coalition, and focus more on conserving public lands and access, and talk a little bit less about the merlet, because we wanted to find common ground with all the different people that were around us and work from there. So I've added back into this presentation some information about old growth and marbled merlets and such. I talked about it to everybody, but in case you're wondering why it's a little sparse on pictures of big old growth forests and things like that, it's because that's the history of why we started this group and who we're trying to work with. Okay, now that you've had the full intro, I'm sorry that was pretty long. Now I'm going to show you a picture. This is a map of where the Elliott State Forest is on the Oregon coast. Of course, here's Coos Bay. This is where I live, and that's Reedsport. So between Coos Bay and Reedsport is about 25 miles. You can see there in green is the Elliott State Forest. So raise your hand if you've ever been to the Elliott State Forest. Okay, wow, a lot of you, way more than I would expect all the way up here in Eugene. Sometimes when I talk in Coos Bay or Bandon or wherever else, not that many people raise their hands. I'm surprised by how many people have never been there in our area, but a lot of people have. So that's great. The Elliott is a really special place because it is one of the only places in our area that you can go without having to pay a fee to hunt. It's like Weyerhaeuser owns a big tree farm down here, and they just shut their gates a few years ago, and you have to pay. So I'm glad you all have been using your public lands. If you zoom in a little bit, we can see same outline right there. It's 91,000 acres right now. If you see those cross-hatched parcels on the side, that's the reason that it's not 93,000 anymore, but we'll get to that a little later. The south side here, where it says, I guess you can't read that, that's the Millicoma River that flows into the south side of the forest, which flows into the Coos River and comes out in Coos Bay. And that's like about 30% of the watershed of the Elliott. Then up on the north side, you have the Umpqua River, which flows out to the ocean in Reedsport. And then on the east side, there's a little town called Lakeside, and there's some lakes there that the water from the west side of the forest is Lakeside. Okay. So this is to show you how big this forest is, because when I say 91,000 acres, it's like kind of hard to have a perspective for what that number means. But this is the outline of the Elliott State Forest overlaid over Eugene Springfield. And as you can see, it's a pretty huge chunk of area. You know, it doesn't look as big on that little map. It also completely covers Salem and mostly covers Portland and covers all of both Corvallis and Albany together in the same map here. But I just brought this Eugene Springfield one tonight because that's where we are. So as Pam mentioned a minute ago, there was a forest fire that came through this area. In the date, there was probably a series of forest fires. You see the little O with the X through it in the corner up there. That's where it's hypothesized that the forest fire started, called the Scottsburg Fire. I was talking at a place in Coos Bay, and there's a guy from a family that has homesteaded in the Elliott a long time ago, and he really strongly holds that this fire was started in Loon Lake, not in 1868, but 1867, and it's like, okay, fair point, but so this may not be completely true and accurate, but it's close enough for what we're talking about. And as you can see, the fire passed through most of the forest, and it's what foresters refer to as a stand-replacing fire. And that's like a high-intensity fire that will burn up even the biggest, oldest trees, which are generally resistant to smaller, less intense fires. And this is something that happens. It's part of the ecology of forests in the Pacific Northwest. On the east side where it's really dry, it might happen, fire might happen every 20, 30 years. And out here in the rainforests of the Coast Range, I think the number is closer to 400, 450 years. So by that time, a lot of fuels have built up and it's a really intense fire. This one was started by people before there was so many people out here, maybe started by lightning. But there's been people living out on, you know, in this area for a long time before colonizers, settlers got here. So maybe also started by fires in the past as well from people. Let's see. So this is a picture from 1915. You can kind of see that stand replacing aspect of the fire. So in the wake of that, we have some pockets of big old growth like this. This is a tree that's 80 inches in diameter. This is one of our volunteers measuring it. And that's about, that's a pretty big old tree. Probably put it somewhere 400, 450 years plus. But I was surprised when I first started going to the Elliott. I went out there with a really incredible woman that's been working on environmental issues in the Elliott for a long time, Frances Hetherington, and she pointed at a tree and said, this tree's 120 years old, and I said, there's no way, it's way too big, it's gotta be like 300. But trees grow fantastically fast in the Elliott. It's really rich soils and tons of rainfall. It's like one of the best timber growing regions in the world. So it's really amazing for the amount of biomass that can spring up out of the forest floor. So there's pockets of the forest that are that look like this. There's not a huge expanse of them in any one place, but fires burn in mosaics, you know, like little patches, and the draws will be skipped over by the fire. Maybe there's little pockets that are moist and were not burned as heavily. So these kinds of trees are all over the Elliott, and there's sometimes patches of pretty numerous amounts of these trees. But only on half the forest, because half the forest has been logged. This is kind of just to show you what a forest that would have burned in that 1868 fire, but is naturally regenerating, might look like. So the trees are not like huge old growth trees, but they're like maturing. They're becoming a mature forest, and there's a good diversity of species of trees and bushes, and there's you know, it's a healthy forest. It's recovering from a natural disturbance. And the half of the forest that has been logged looks, you know, kind of like that in the foreground, depending on how recently it was harvested or clear cut. And this picture also gives you kind of a good lay of the land here, where it's not like they took the south half and said, we're going to cut all this and leave the north half. You have like a sea of clear cuts with a sea of 140-year-old forests with pockets. You know, it's all interspersed together. Throughout the whole forest. And what we end up with for ages across the forest is a graph like this. So this side we have acreage, so that's just the amount of acreage in a certain age class. Bottom is the age class. So we see kind of like two bumps here. We have a bunch of trees in the 10 to 60 years range, and then a bunch in the 110 to 160. And what you're seeing there is on this side, this was the fire. This is where the trees have started coming back naturally after the fire. And then here, you're seeing the harvested and replanted tree farms. In the 1950s, the Department of Forestry started logging the Elliott. And before then, it was kind of just left alone. So here's trees that have been replanted since harvest, and these are the ones that are naturally regenerating after the fire. I should say here an important distinction between stand age and tree age. So this is stand age, which is taking a big area of trees and averaging their ages out. So within this 140-year-old stand, you probably have a bunch of trees around 100, a bunch of trees around 140, and then maybe some older, like the ones you saw in the picture in the slide before, mixed in there. So that's when I see a stand age of 140, I'm thinking there's pockets of old growth and then maybe some younger stuff as well. Down here, this is all even-aged plantation. The Department of Forestry manages the Elliott in the same way that a private timber company does, where they clear cut, replant with mostly Douglas fir, kind of like a cornfield. Yeah. Okay, so this is going to seem really boring, and I'll try not to get lost in the weeds here, but stick with me for a few slides, because it's important to the situation we're in now. But the history of the Elliott is that when the state was accepted into the union, or the territory was accepted into the union as a state, the federal government granted Oregon sections 16 and 36 of every township and range. So this is showing one township and range square, which is a grid that runs across the entire country that divides all the land in the country into one square mile blocks. And this is just a way to catalog and inventory lands. So when the state was granted lands, they were granted every one of these squares, 16, and every one of these squares, 36 across the entire state for the purpose of creating and funding a school system. And this makes a lot of sense if you are a land rich and cash poor territory like Oregon was. So they were able to sell some of these lands and raise revenue from cattle leases or timber in order to start a school system. So the way that this relates to the Elliott is that, think about if it's your job to manage sections 16 and 36 scattered throughout the entire state. How much gas are you going to spend? How much gas money are you going to spend driving to each one square mile parcel all over the entire state of Oregon? It's a kind of a nightmare to try and manage lands in that way. So in the 1930s, or it was actually before the 1930s, the first state forester of Oregon, Francis Elliott, and a bunch of other people got together and decided to try to consolidate some of these little squares into one big patch of forest that can be managed more easily. So that's eventually what happened. I should say, as an aside here, that like 2/3 of the land that Oregon was granted in this way are now not in public ownership anymore. There was a huge series of land scandals in the early 1900s that landed a bunch of federal official or state officials in jail. There's like people were in jail for a long time because they basically just swindled the public, us, out of a bunch of land that they gave to their friends in business. And that land didn't come back when they got in trouble and got sent to jail. But, you know, that's still Weyerhaeuser land or, you know, wherever it is now. But the Elliott remained. So this is the tract of land that was to become the Elliott. That's the Umpqua River on the north side of that square there. I'll zoom back a few slides so we can look at it in the other map. So here's the Umpqua River, north side of the forest. Umpqua River, north side of the forest. So this is most of the Elliott. I think it was like 80,000, 82,000 acres. The other lands in the Elliott are under a different management directive than these lands. Remember, the Common School Fund lands, which used to be 16 and 36, and they traded and consolidated, managed for the to generate revenue for the schools. Now, there are some other lands that are also part of the Elliott State Forest, more because they were already owned by the counties before the forest was started, and it was just kind of lumped into one forest. So you see two colors on this map. The pink is the common school lands, and the blue is the Board of Forestry lands. And the Board of Forestry lands are, the revenue from Board of Forestry lands is divided back out to the county. So it's a different management directive, and the current plan to sell the forest only applies to this common school lands. All the blue stuff, Board of Forestry, stays in public ownership. Okay, so everything went swimmingly for quite a while. They were able to harvest, about 45,000 acres of that forest. And here we go. This is, they're chugging along. Back here, you would see some higher ups, some higher highs. But this is the board footage that they got off of the forest starting at 1995. So years that way, amount that way. So this would represent average about $13 million a year for the forest. I didn't find the one in dollars. I just found the one in board feet. But I did talk to the manager of the forest for a long time, and he said $13 million annually average is about right. So they're chugging along and chugging along and chugging along. They're like chugging along back here. And then in the early 90s, we had the endangered species listing of the northern spotted owl and the marbled murrelet. So they had a dip there. They started losing money because they had to reconfigure their plan. Funny, at that time, they didn't talk about selling the forest. They just figured out how to work around those things. And then 1995, they started what's called a habitat conservation plan. And that is an agreement with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service that allows for a land manager to take or kill some endangered species with the agreement that they'll protect habitat in the long run. And this was a 60-year plan, I believe. And they agreed to protect X amount of habitat for a long time over that plan in order to be able to kill 60 spotted owls, so 30 pairs of owls in the meantime. So after, I think it was like 2008 or so, they started saying, we want out of this plan. They'd already got all their 60 owls. They didn't want to go for the other 42 years or whatever it was. So they did that. They changed their management plan. I'm still a little frustrated by how that was allowed. I thought it was an agreement, but that's what happened. And they started talking about different ways to manage the forest. Most of them involved cutting a lot more timber, and that's eventually what they agreed on in 2011, was upping the board footage to an estimated 40 million board feet a year, which, let's go back here. Oh, wait. So this high is at 40. The highest peak up there is at 40. So they're talking about going from, like, doubling their timber production, which is a big jump, right? So here's the marbled murrelet. This is a picture of a marbled murrelet. Very cute. I'll tell you a little bit more about the marbled murrelet in just a second. But and that plan to get that much more board footage out of the forest while there's endangered birds living on the forest, while they don't have an agreement with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service protecting them from legal challenge if they kill endangered species, got them in a lot of trouble. Because guess what? They went after the biggest